really setting an example for the rest of the district as to what the future holds in transportation. So very impressive, and I'm so glad I was here to hear that. But it is also my great pleasure to be here representing Secretariat Fox, who has done similar things for our nation in terms of setting an example of direction for what transportation needs to be in the 21st century in the United States. No, it's not exactly the same group, but I wanted to congratulate this year's APPP award recipients. All of them have done outstanding work and are more than deserving of these important awards. Notably, Dan Goodman of the Federal Highway Administration, who is this year's professional of the year.
In March 2015,
2015, Secretary Fox launched the Mayor's Challenge component of the Safer People, Safer Streets initiative. This was a call to action for mayors and elected officials to take significant steps to improve safety for bicyclists and pedestrians of all ages and abilities. 246 communities joined the challenge and made a commitment to improving bicyclist and pedestrian safety by issuing a public statement about the importance of bicycle and pedestrian safety, forming local action teams to advance safety and accessible roads, and taking local action. Over the last year and a half, USDOT has provided resources and assistance to communities in making progress on these seven challenge activities. Of the communities that reported their progress to USDOT through a survey and or awards application, we have been able to document the following outcomes from the Mayor's Challenge. 12 communities reported adopted complete streets policies. Many cities conducted road safety assessments, took inventories of existing pedestrian and bicycle facilities, and created safer street crossings. Cities installed 36 new systems to count pedestrians and cyclists, and 14 cities collected survey data from pedestrians and bicyclists. Many cities developed new design standards and manuals, taking advantage of the design flexibility, and they started redesigning their streets using road diets and separated bike lanes to improve safety for pedestrians and bicyclists. 11 cities reported that they constructed more than 370 miles of pedestrian and bicycle lanes. More than 40 cities reported on safety education, including several educational programs for school-age kids, which reached over 10,000 students. So we have been busy, but we are far from finished. This Friday, we are holding a summit at USDOT headquarters in Washington to bring together mayors and other representatives from among the 246 cities participating in the Mayor's Challenge. We will be recognizing cities that have made the most progress during the challenge with awards in each challenge area, as well as Secretary's award for overall excellence. USDOT will continue to provide leadership, funding, resources, and other support to promote safe walking and bicycling. We are in the process of institutionalizing department-wide collaborative efforts and establishing a set of goals and metrics to help us track national progress on pedestrian and bicycle activity and safety on an annual basis. So we've been busy, but we're looking for ways to be even busier. Progress doesn't happen without effort and without commitment. Despite this progress, we know that road fatalities in the U.S. increased last year to more than 35,000. The increase in pedestrian and bicycle fatalities was especially significant. We are dedicated to reducing this number. USDOT safety is our top priority, and this applies to all of us. Any roadway fatality is too many, which is why our goal will always be zero deaths. We have made great progress in so many ways, but the bottom line in 2015 was that more people died than the previous year. Clearly, we need to work harder and smarter. America's roads can and must be safer for all who use them, regardless of motor traffic. We are working with new partners to use new methods to analyze the crash data and determine the most effective ways to bring those fatalities down. We will be discussing ways to reduce roadway fatalities on Friday, how we can determine the cause of the increase, and to redouble our efforts to address it. As I said, safety is our top priority. That has never been more clear than now. USDOT will continue to provide leadership, funding, resources, and other support to promote safe walking and bicycling. We are also institutionalizing our collaboration throughout the USDOT and establishing a set of goals and performance metrics to track national progress on pedestrian and bicycle activity, safety, each and every year. Today, the Federal Highway Administration is announcing its strategic agenda for pedestrian and bicycle transportation. As I speak, it's being posted on our website, www.federalhighway.gov. It sets out two aspirational goals: reduce pedestrian and bicycle fatalities and serious injuries by 80% in 15 years, and strive for zero pedestrian bicycle fatalities and serious injuries in the next 23 years. guide the work of the Federal Highway Administration over the next 3 to 5 years to ensure that the progress we've made will not slow down. It is organized around 4 goals: networks, safety, equity, and trips. And each goal includes activities related to capacity building, policy data, and research. It emphasizes the use of existing resources and building on a policy statement on bicycle and pedestrian accommodations. The volume and type of activities it includes demonstrates Federal Highway's ongoing leadership on multimodal transportation and represents our commitment to institutionalize and mainstream these issues going forward. We're promoting pedestrian and bicycle planning, design, and safety resources, convening peer exchange, and other outreach, updating policies, fostering active public participation in the planning and decision-making process, and leading pedestrians and bicycle assessments and audits. All of these things are essential to what I call institutionalizing this commitment and ensuring that it is ongoing. The commitment is ongoing. The resources are ongoing. And I think this is broaden across the spectrum. I think some of the most ardent advocates for bicycle and pedestrian safety and access in cities are business leaders, because they've learned and seen the impact it can have on their community, on their customers, on their quality of life. So institutionalizing these practices within institutions like the USDOT, the Federal Highway, and importantly, state departments of transportation and local transportation agencies around our country is how we're going to continue this commitment and ongoing momentum behind what has been really, I think, an extraordinary movement. So we're ensuring accessibility for all users while also pushing innovation by identifying and filling gaps in knowledge and practice, promoting design flexibility, encouraging and facilitating experimentation and conducting new research. I want to wrap up by talking a little bit about my boss and something called ladders of opportunity. Planning is really where opportunities lie. And we are actively encouraging American communities to plan for the needs of a growing bike and pedestrian population. Our culture is shifting in that direction, as it is in many countries. One of the most important opportunities you have in planning for the future is to reverse or avoid some of the errors that really were made in the past. We have to learn from those mistakes. Secretary Fox has started a national conversation about the link between transportation and opportunity. He encourages us to think of transportation not just as a way to get from point A to point B, but as ladders of opportunity, linking people safely and efficiently to a job, to an education, to their doctors, or anything that impacts their quality of life. Offering safe places for bicyclists and pedestrians to travel is central to this philosophy. We are connecting people to opportunity. Secretary Fox has made a lasting contribution by putting this subject high on the public agenda. This is not just a professional issue with the Secretary of Graham, it's very personal. He grew up in a neighborhood in Charlotte, North Carolina, that was essentially trapped between two interstates. It limited access to the neighborhood, discouraged grocery stores, pharmacies, and other businesses from opening. It also had a psychological impact. Gave the people who lived there a sense that they were second-class citizens. This problem was certainly not limited to Charlotte. And it wasn't just because of interstate highways, airports, railroads, transit facilities that divided communities, damaged local businesses, and cut people off from opportunities they deserve. But again, those mistakes and sins of the past, we've learned a lot since then. However, focusing on pedestrian and bicycle networks has a unifying effect. They create community. They unite instead of divide. As we look to the future and make transportation decisions that will have long-lasting impact, decades, in some cases, a century, the Secretary urges us to consider both the big picture and the small picture, the macro and the micro perspectives. The big picture, of course, is the interstate's unquestioned role in supporting the national economy and linking the United States together. But on the micro side, we need to take into account the historical impact, often harmful, it had on individual neighborhoods and communities, and explore options. options for reconnecting communities that will have long-term benefits. The bicycle and pedestrian community has long championed community-based solutions like these in the sector, and I do too, because they work. We have a chance to rebuild the system so it works for everyone in all communities, connecting people to opportunity without harming people on its path, and building projects by, for, and with the impact of the communities that are impacted by it. Secretary Fox has called upon me, as my highway administrator, my team, his teams, and all of us to accept this new challenge and make the kind of transportation decisions by which everyone in every community will benefit. The Secretary directed and produced something called Beyond Traffic 2045. And basically his objective was to develop an analysis of what's coming, what we can expect in our country with respect to transportation and the needs of transportation in the 21st century. A couple of basic statistics that really reshaped the dialogue we're having in the United States. One was, in the next 30 years, a growth of 70 million people in our population. And it's going to generate a 45% increase in freight movement as a result of that demand. And that 70 million population growth will occur in about 11 mega regions of our country. Basically tied to the reurbanization of America, where millennials want to be in the future, and how our transportation system needs to adapt to those trends changing demographic realities. And I think what the Secretary has done with Beyond Traffic has really redefined the conversation we're having in America about the future of transportation, because what it says is, in order for our economy to thrive without choking us with a 45% increase in freight, some cities in America, some sort of urban freight hubs, that could be as high as 60 to 70% on a system that today isn't capable of handling the kind of impact. So we have got massive investments to make in systems that will relieve the congestion that will be caused by these, what I call, forces of nature. This is coming. It's going to happen. I was in a great roundtable yesterday that I hosted in St. Louis. It was the 24th and last of 24 cities across America focusing on this challenge, on the challenge of coming with freight. My colleague, Chip Jadkin, is the administrator of agency was there as well. We talked about it, a $50 million investment USDA made in the Marine Highway that was going to divert thousands of trucks from the highway onto water. A system that is thoroughly underutilized, and a system we're going to have to maximize the capacity of in order to relieve the congestion of the highways and ensure that the impact of that growth doesn't choke us but creates ladders of opportunity. That demand is going to present an economic boom for the nation if we invest in the right systems to handle growth. So all of that is ahead of us. You have charted a path to looking at community-based solutions that improve the lives of people and improve the economy. So you are to be congratulated for the work you've done, the work you're going to do. It contributes mightily to ensuring that we can move people and goods and improve the quality of life of communities at the same time because of what we learned. So keep up the good work. Thank you so much. Secretary Fox can't be more grateful for the work certainly you're all doing in the United States and the work we're all doing together around the world, because every day, every month, every year, we're learning from each other. So thank you very much, and I certainly hope you enjoy the rest of the day.